Tonight, Road to the Olympic Games runs through Boston. The figure skating world gathers for its season summit. So much is at stake. Three-time world champion Patrick Chan tries to complete his comeback story. But his rivals, the defending world champion Javier Fernandez and Olympic champion Yuzuru Hanyu, vow to stand in his way. Can Gracie Gold become the first American woman to win in a decade and do it on home ice? The Olympic champions in pairs, Tatiana Volososhar and Maxim Trankov, are here to stake their claim. But eager to repeat as world champions are Canada's Megan Duhamel and Eric Radford. And in the big dance, Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poggé are on the threshold of continuing a great Canadian figure skating tradition. It's all ahead on Road to the Olympic Games on CBC. Road to the Olympic Games, presented by Petro-Canada. Springtime in Boston, Massachusetts, one of the oldest and most historic cities in the United States. A city of sport where Patriots, Celtics, Red Sox, and Bruins play. Boston is a city of revolution and resolution. And perhaps, as winter recedes, a city of renaissance for a pursuit which has long been a passion for Americans. Namely, figure skating. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the ice at the Garden in Boston, Road to the Olympic Games and the 2016 World Figure Skating Championships on CBC. I'm Scott Russell. This is the first time the United States has hosted these championships since 2009 in Los Angeles, and you can feel the energy coming from the ice. The next Olympic Winter Games in Pyeongchang, South Korea, are less than 2 years away, and everybody's jockeying for position. And there is so much at stake in each of figure skating's four disciplines. In the ice dance, Canadian contenders are hoping to continue a long string of success at the World Championships. In the pairs, the Canadians are the world champions, but they're desperately trying to hold off their advancing rivals. In the ladies' competition, a local hero born in Boston is trying to restore some past glory to her sport. And tonight, the men's competition begins with the short program. A three-time world champion from Canada is trying to write a successful comeback story. Patrick Chan is 25 years of age, and he's in the lion's den tonight. He's had a roller coaster season, and now he must face his rivals, the Olympic champion Yuzuru Hanyu of Japan and the reigning world champion Javier Fernandez of Spain. Chan will have to be great tonight here in Boston to get the job done. Let's advance the story now and send it to the booth with Andy Petrillo, four-time world champion Kurt Browning, and Olympic coach Carol Lane.
Scott, that date you mentioned, 2009 in L.A., that was the first time Patrick Chan won a world medal. That was a silver. In fact, he was a two-time silver medalist before becoming a three-time world champion. This is his comeback season after taking all of last year off. Kurt, how would you assess it?
It hasn't been easy to come back. The rest of the group had momentum, and they changed the sport in only 1 year. Now it's Quadville, multiple quads, and he has struggled to catch back up, especially in the short program, and that's where it's been giving him trouble. Now, he's put up some big scores this year, which means he can do it. He can be on the podium here at this Worlds, but the short program has really been catching him. And so what we've seen is mistakes that have really kept him from being able to capitalize on a great long. We're seeing here national championships, January, vintage Chan. And then about a month later at the Four Continents Championships, not as much confidence. That's what we've been hearing is happening in his practices at home, and that is what we've been seeing this week in practice as well. If he does it this week, it'll be more by guts than a solid training regime coming in.
We need the Chantastic Patrick this week, that's
for
sure.
He needs it, yeah.
Yeah, he does.
Well, this is how incredible Patrick Chan has been, because when you look at the top scores when it comes to men, he is still in the top five. You can see him there sitting in fourth, which shows that he was ahead of his time. But at the same time, as you mentioned, Kurt, it does show how the rest of the field has caught up when you also see the marks of Hanyu and Fernandez. And let's talk about Hanyu, especially that mark he put up, the Grand Prix final, yeah. Or I should even say an NHK trophy
and
before
that. He did it
twice. race. He became the first skater to break the 300-point barrier, and that was an otherworldly body experience that he had there, Carol.
Well, he's basically taken himself to a place where he's pretty much unbeatable. It's like he wakes up every morning and goes, what can I do today that nobody else in the world can do?
And do it, yeah, just do it. And you know what, if anyone else wins a world title at this competition, it'll be because he gifted it to him. That'll
yeah,
be
absolutely.
The only way.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, let's not also forget the reigning world champion. That would be Javi Fernandez, the first time a Spaniard has won a world title. He's had a great season as well. He, too, broke the 300-point barrier. That was at Euros, winning that title once again.
And I think his success is by being able to capitalize on all his natural talent and charm. Brian Orser and their camp have been able to do that for him.
So let's take a look at the first flight of skaters that we will be seeing. There is the 2015 Canadian national champ, Nam Nguyen. We will see him. Adam Rippon is the reigning national U.S. champion. And there is Boyang Jin. He is the one Hanyu credits for pushing him, because Boyang Jin, we call him
Boyang
Jin, because he does so many quads. And Yuzuru Hanyu says, that's the reason why I am pushing myself to be the best this season. We'll see the 18-year-old Boyang Jin later, but first, it's the birthday boy, Mihail Brzezina, turning 26 today. Two-time and reigning Czech Republic champion.
And more importantly and more interesting is that in 2010, he was fourth in the world, 2011, fourth in the world, and it's been kind of a tough battle ever since. He hasn't gotten back up to that stratosphere. Speaking of stratosphere, here comes Triple Axel. This kid can do it. Huge. Too big. A little bit of fight in that landing. I don't always like music to compete with lyrics. I do like this one. A shout out to Jeffrey Buttle, Canadian world champion, an extraordinary talented choreographer. He put this program together. Quad sound, no, big lean, and it's down. He was nailing that jump in practice. Looked poised to make a move in this short program.
And he actually had the quad toe and the quad sound now years ago, and was doing them consistently, and then was made to leave them out of programs. And from then on, it became a puzzle he couldn't solve.
Not a good strategy, it turned out. And he reached back, refired for the nice triple turn.
Has a very elegant skater. Actually, he reminds me of Jeff Buttle. I think he was a very good choice for choreography for Mihail. He's done a really super job with this program. So many interesting little choreographic moments for Mihail to develop along the way.
Subtle and super.
Birthday boy Mihail Brzezina from the Czech Republic. And you guys have said it, it's been a tough year for him. Really, the only big win was at Nationals, defending his title, but actually posted his worst placing at Euros since 2009, when he placed 10th. So trying to get back on track. Last year at Worlds, he was 15th.
We dearly want to have the risk of doing a quad in the short program pay off? The judges this year have been given the option of taking -4 off of a quad. And that's new to make sure that you can't fall on a bunch of quads and get a bunch of points. It's probably a good rule, not one that Mikhail agrees with at this moment, because the punishment is pretty extreme when you take the risk and don't make the leap.
He said he wants to get back to the way he was, as you mentioned, early 2000s. Even as, you know, early as 5 years ago, was doing really well, and he competed in a lot of competitions this season. He so badly wants to be near the top and back on a podium.
Sometimes the wanting can just take over and get in the way of you doing exactly what you want to do. He's had troubles with consistency, you can see there, struggling to hold on to that exit edge of the jump.
It's because it was too much of a good thing. That was a huge triple axel, even for him. Quad Sal, you can see, just was not, the upper body and the lower body were not friends. They weren't talking. There was a big fight. And he just wasn't a one unit.
And in his combination, he had a little loss of balance there, so an extra turn between the two jumps.
And an extra point deduction as well.
Gets another point gone, and it keeps racking up and racking up.
Well, the short program is really about strategy. What do you and your team, your coach, know you can do on that given day? And absolutely, you really have to have a game plan that works for you, because you can, as we've said many times before, take yourself out of the competition. Can't win it today, but you can sure lose it.
For some people, three jumps and three spins is easy peasy, and for other people, it's a minefield, like walking into the valley of death.
Mihail Brzezina of the Czech Republic awaiting his marks here.
Happy birthday. Wish it was... Wish I could give you that quad sal back, but.
Now he's posted a season best of 84.30. I don't think it'll be close to that, given how that short program went down. How far off is it? 79.29, so that'll put him outside of a podium spot at the moment here in the short. Here comes our next skater.
Next to the ice, representing Uzbekistan, ladies and gentlemen, Misha G
of Uzbekistan, two-time national champion. He was sixth at Worlds last year, and a huge improvement for him because the year before, he was 27. So a huge jump for him to finish sixth last season. Can he pull off something extraordinaire again this season?
Last season, when he made that leap up in the world ranks, he found a triple axel, tamed it, and put it in this program, coupled with amazing choice of music, choreography, and he was so entertaining. This year, a much more serious version of Misha. There's the triple axel, tiny 2 foot. Better than practices this week, he'll take it.
But he doesn't have a quad in his short program, so he's going to be relying on doing everything else absolutely inch perfect. Triple lutz, triple toe. Not a lot of speed coming out, but nice and clean.
Change of direction in those spins. And if you want to know how hard that is, try writing an essay with your opposite hand. Three jumping passes in the short program. This is his third one. Single jump, triple flip. Not in combination, because he's already got that done with the triple lutz, triple toe.
Mm-hmm.
jumps, jumping passes, three spins, and one footwork sequence make up the short program. And as soon as the arms start swinging around, you know that it's the footwork sequence. I know that doesn't make sense, but the judges are looking for upper body movement as well as fast feet.
Misha's unusual in that he lists himself as his choreographer, doesn't go to anyone specifically to have his programs done. It's his own ideas and his own thoughts.
And it's thrifty, too.
Yes. But it's lovely to see a skater who actually thinks for themselves. It's great.
Well, the crowd liked that. Misha, gee, a strong performance by him, coached by his parents from the start. Actually grew up in China because that's where they were coaching, and he's fluent in Chinese, Russian, and English. So a strong performance by the young Misha Gee. We will have more skaters, including the Canadian Nam Nguyen, coming up. There's a look at Brian Orser and Javi Fernandez, the reigning world champion.
No, he's going on in,
as we welcome you back to Road to Olympic Games, presented by Petro-Canada. Some last-minute advice there, perhaps?
The magic words.
Or more just telling him what time he's on the ice.
Yeah.
Make sure you're not late.
You're on in 45 minutes. Don't go anywhere, kid.
How about his other pupil, Yuzuru Hanyu? What an incredible season he has had, setting records all over the place. And let's not forget the trifecta here. Nam Nguyen, the 2015 national Canadian champion, looking to do better than his exceptional fifth place finish last season at Worlds. Let's hear what the young skater has to say about Worlds last year compared to this time around.
Well, going into this competition, I don't have a lot of pressure that I'm feeling right now, because I didn't really deserve it at first, but when I got called to do it, I was very excited. Overall, I'm just super excited to be here, and I want to do my best.
Nam, of course, referring to the fact that he finished fourth at Nationals this season, but Liam Ferris stepped away and gave his position to Nam here. So Nam and Patrick Chan representing Canada.
A little shout out to Liam. I know you're watching, cheering your teammates on. Brian Orser gave up wearing the team jackets for all the countries that he works
for. He couldn't keep changing.
Just went for one suit.
Just wear the generic suit.
He's every man of skating.
You know, it had to have been a tough season for Nam Nguyen. As mentioned, the 2015 national champion, and then Patrick Chan comes back. And it's not just any skater.
No.
It's Patrick Chan, right? So it's your three-time world champion. So suddenly he's trying to find himself again, Nam himself going through a growth spurt. He is only 17 years old, and then Patrick's back.
There's no time for training because he's always shopping for new clothes.
Well, he struggled a bit with the short program too this year, but he's actually made a change and gone back to his old Cineman program by Nina Simone, hoping that that comfort level will enable him to deliver a better performance.
Hardest jump in the program. He's putting it in combination, but he's actually been hitting it quite well this week. The quad toe.
Oh. Just looked a little tentative coming down the ice, not carrying quite as much speed as we've seen from him in the past.
That takeoff did not work. The timing was wrong. It looked like he was way back on the blade. And he decided not to do it. He will get no points whatsoever for that particular effort.
And although I said at the beginning of the program that he switched back to his cinema, and this is actually his Killing Fields program, so he switched again.
Now that is a definite victory of sorts. The planned quad triple obviously didn't work with the fall off the top, and he put a triple toe after that. Lutz, you can't just throw in a jump if you missed it. You've only got three jumping opportunities. You have to capitalize on those three jumps. I mean, sorry, those three corridors, we call them, to get in your axel, your combination, and your triple jump. Or quad.
The Canadian, Nam Nguyen. You can tell by the look on his face, not too pleased with that short. And I know from his clip, he said maybe he didn't feel as much pressure going into this one, these worlds compared to last season, but it's pressure on both him and Patrick to combine for 13 points in order to have the maximum spots for next year's World Championships, three spots.
Very good point.
And it doesn't matter what you say, once you get out on that ice at Worlds, you want it. Mm-hmm. You want to skate well. You want to do your best. But you can see Nam has grown tremendously, and it's affected his speed, his balance, his feeling on the blade. It's a hard job to get through when you grow like that.
He told me himself, he said, I just don't quite know where I left my jumps. I just can't figure it out. And this is somebody who's a wee bit of a phenom. He's a natural performer. And you can see that he, instead of waiting for the right moment to pull the trigger and that takeoff of that axel, that right arm was swinging around like he wanted to punch somebody. And that's just wanting it too much, not having the confidence to wait for the timing. But hats off to him. I'm wearing one today. Hats off to him.
And you took it off. Well,
for that triple, that's triple toe. We're talking a junior world champion, former junior world champion, and he was fifth in the worlds last year, I think. Mm-hmm. So much potential for this young man. This is just one day at the office.
Yeah. Don't write him off. He's going to be around for a long time.
Awaiting the marks, the Canadian, Nam Nguyen. Season best, 76.10 for him. We'll see what scores they give him here and where that places him.
A lot of skaters will take a moment like this and go, I remember what I felt like sitting in that kiss and cry. I don't want to feel like that again. Mm-hmm. I want to, you know, allow myself to go down, but I'm going to find a way to get back up. This is a great sport in that they cannot take away your moment away from you. They can give you whatever mark you want, but nobody hits the ball past you. They don't punch you and you fall over. No. It's your moment to deal with the way you want. And, like I said, he came down the ice and did that triple X triple toe, and that's claiming the moment back.
Absolutely.
The score, please. And here come the scores for Nam Nguyen. Time to look up and see what they are. So pretty far off the season best, 61.61. That'll put him in 18th. A lot of ground to make up there again if they do want to maximize their spots for next year's World Championships.
I think top 20 do the long program, 24,
right.
Sorry, 24. And so we'll be watching the scores pretty carefully. He has to make that long program.
Yes, there is an American on the ice, hence the loud cheers.
What was your first clue?
Not just any American, the reigning national champion, Adam Rippon. And you know, he actually said, I'm like a witch, you can't kill me. And he was referring to after 8 years on the senior circuit, he finally got the national title. And I'm not going to lie, I'm a little disappointed that he no longer has lavender hair.
Well, if you Google him and watch some of his older programs, you'll see a cherub skating with the golden locks, curls. He's a much more buff, fit, serious athlete, capable of the quad lutz. He won't be doing it here. Triple flip, clean triple toe, quality. When you're not throwing a quad in the short, you're looking for everything to be spot on.
He's so neat and tight in the air, makes his jumps very pretty to look at.
That's the fitness coming in the air. I called it no, but all that hard work, he said yes.
Adam's got a great pedigree. He's a two-time junior world champion, so he knows about competing at the highest level. He knows what's required. He knows how to compete.
Best jump for him is his lutz. Saving that for last. It'll be in the second half of the program. We'll get a little bump on the marks. Never a doubt.
Not very often you see a gentleman do a layback spin, and definitely not one as nice as that one.
And they're on their feet. National champion Adam Rippon with a strong short program here. You couple that with skating to Queen, and you've got a combination that is a winning one. Enjoy the moment, Adam. More coming up on CBC Sports.
Welcome back to Road to the Olympic Games, presented by Petro Canada. There is the reigning Canadian national champion, Patrick Chan, on the bike. We will be seeing his skate in about 45 minutes' time here at the 2016 World Figure Skating Championships.
Next to the ice, from China, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Boye Jin.
And this 18-year-old is the reason why Hanyu is having a great season. But what a senior debut for Boyang Jin from China, the 18-year-old. Two second-place finishes on the Grand Prix circuit. Qualifies for the Grand Prix final. He is the three-time and reigning Chinese national champion. He can jump.
Will do something I would have never dreamed was going to happen in our sport. Doing a quad lutz in the short program and planning it in combination. Little trouble. He'll take a slight deduction, but he gets the job done.
Actually beat Patrick Chan in the technical score in the long program at Four Continents, but Patrick's superior technical component skills took the day. I swear this boy has spring-loaded skates.
He, too, has commented on how much he's grown over the past year. He said his costumes weren't fitting so well anymore. It's usually an indicator.
Keeps landing quads like that, he's going to have to get a bigger pocketbook, too. Just turned 18. He's a good foundation for a team to build on. Not a bad skater. He's aware of the music, even aware of the audience. Not just a jumper.
Even since we saw him at the beginning of the Grand Prix season, he's presenting a much more mature attitude on the ice than he was even 6 months ago.
And he's in warm-ups with the best skaters in the world now, so that's got to rub off. You like the first quad? Here's another.
Oh. Game on, everybody.
Jump that much? You saw it for your own eyes. Boyang Jin from China. First man this season to complete six quads in a competition. See what he has planned for us in the free, but we'll have his marks when we return here on Road to the Olympic Games from Boston. Boyang Jin with a great short program here. He is just a quad jumping machine. And we saw the wonderful skate of the American Adam Rippon, who is currently sitting in second, but no quads in his program. And then you see Boyang.
Well, you didn't see the boing boing that we've been seeing all year. He did do two quads, but he didn't get the extra bonus part marks that he usually gets on those quads. So when it comes to technical jumping, he is usually even more deadly. Today was a tiny bit off, so he wasn't getting the extra 1.8 on each jump or 2.1 that he was usually getting. And then someone like Adam Rippon can do so well without the quad because of everything else. He still has to grow in that area. But what a quad Lutz combination in the short program. He obviously failed science class. Nobody explained gravity to this kid.
And I mean, even with the little turn between the two jumps in the combination, he still scored like over 16 points just on that one element.
Yeah, the quad Lutz triple toe, he holds the world record for the most points got, derived, I'll say, from one element.
Yeah.
Which is like 21 or 20, I can't remember what it is.
19 something, I think.
Really? All right.
Yeah.
No, he must be so irritating to compete against, right? He kind of comes out of nowhere. Yeah. You know, going into the rink of competition and seeing the quad Lutz triple toe going, what? Oh, come on. Now I have that to deal with?
Well, it's curious to see the bar that he set for next season, right? Because this is his first year on the senior circuit.
Yes.
So now he's going to need to beat 89.67.
And next year he'll have self-awareness to do it. Possibly.
And he does beat it. 89.86, that will put him in the lead. So the young Boyang Jin once again serving notice here at the World Championships. And he wants to be on the podium. This is his first senior World Championships. Here is another American, Max Aaron. Competing at his third World Championships. He's the national champion in 2013. This year, national silver medalist.
And throughout the season, we've been commenting on how he's looking less like a hockey player, which is a sport he played up until 2009, and more like a figure skater.
His costumes are great this season. He's trimmed down, his body looks in great shape, and everything he wears is drawing attention to that in a very positive way.
Edge jumps. They do not put the toe in, and usually you don't take it with that much speed. Four revolutions. I'm sure that the judges will give them the four revolutions. They get quality for the jump. I mean, marks for the jump, just not extra quality for the land.
Bit of jump math now, because that was supposed to be his combinations, and now he's going to figure out where he's going to do it.
I doubt he'll put it here. Triple axel. That was right. A few years ago, I would have thought he wouldn't be able to handle this music, but he has come a long way with how he presents himself, carries himself on the ice.
His choreographer, Philip Mills, has done a really wonderful job with the programs this year. Beautiful.
See him doing footwork into this jump. Nice job.
Good job.
That's because he was planning on doing quad sal combination, which doesn't demand footwork into it. And because that one is usually just a single triple, that's why the choreography had the footwork planned into it. The quad sal will take a little ding in the marks because there was no footwork going into it. Is everyone at home confused enough yet?
The wonderful world of marking figure skating.
American silver medalist Max Aaron started off the Grand Prix season with a bang, gold at Skate America. In fact, that was his first ever gold on the Grand Prix circuit, but then was disappointed in his performance at the Grand Prix of France, seventh place there, so once was unable to qualify for the Grand Prix final. And Kurt, a lot of people thought maybe he should have won the national title because he had quads in his. It goes back to that conversation of, are the quads important, or it's the beautiful skate with everything else being perfect far more important?
They're absolutely important, right up until the point they're not important. You
know, that answered my question perfectly.
Thank you. I'm now running for mayor. what happens is that they play a role as long as there's everything else. That's why Yuzuru Ohanyu is so stellar, Patrick Chan as well. Because the framework around their quads is so strong. Max Aaron has come a long way musically, and that triple axel is beautiful, by the way. He's come a long way musically, but he's not the skater that those kinds of skaters are. He doesn't have quite the softness, the smoothness. And wouldn't you agree, Carol, that the landings of the jumps are not, like, he's not getting extra grade of execution,
no.
Extra points on every element everywhere he goes.
But I do think he's gone from, you know, your Hans Zimmer men's free skate type of skater to someone who is actually now potentially quite an artist. That's a huge jump for him. Like you said, you never would have expected to see him do a program like this.
And I think he did
so
a
nicely.
Great job.
Yeah, me too.
And I think all the fans agree.
Well, we've been talking about that since the start of the season, where he's really been trying to shed the hockey player
exactly.
look and trying to be more artistic.
But to properly answer your question, you really need to be one of the best skaters on the planet and memorable and special without a quad, and to be able to challenge for the top nowadays. And that's why Patrick Chan has it hard to come back. He left the sport only a year ago with two quads in the long. And now we've had people do six in one competition, which means they're doing multiple quads. You can only repeat one style of quad twice, which means you're doing a toe, a sow, and something else, either a loop or a lutz, it seems. Yeah. And once you get into quad loops, flips, and lutzes, that's a lot of points.
Scary territory.
A lot of points.
Max Aaron of the United States awaiting his marks. And here they come. He's going to need 89.87 to take the lead, or at least an 85.73 to be in the top three. He won't get there. 81.28. That'll just put him outside the top three. He'll be sitting in fourth. And then the moment the Canadians have been waiting for. The final flight is coming up here in Boston, and that includes three-time world champion Patrick Chan. Welcome back to Road to the Olympic Games, presented by Petro-Canada. Final flight in the men here at the short program. 2016 World Figure Skating Championships in Boston, Massachusetts. There they go to take to the ice for the warm-up. Saw there leading the way, Yuzuru Hanyu. And all three men who stood on the podium at last year's Worlds in this flight. Javi Fernandez, the reigning world champion, Yuzuru Hanyu was right behind him in silver. And then Dennis Tan took the bronze. But there is Patrick Chan. This is the comeback year for him. He regained his national title. He regained his four continents title. Can he take back his world title? It all begins tonight. For more on that, let's go ringside with Scott Russell.
Well, thanks very much, Andy. Yes, Patrick Chan has returned to the ice. You know, once he was this sport's boy wonder, and now he's a highly experienced skater. He has won everything there is to win, with one glaring exception. That's the Olympic gold medal. Over the years, he's ruffled some feathers. He's made a huge impression, and now he continues the chase. Yes, Patrick Chan has returned to the ice, but his comeback story is far from complete.
Patrick, now that you're on the edge of the biggest competition this season, how do you reflect on the comeback? Is it as difficult as you thought it would be?
At the beginning of the season, I felt like it would have been a much smoother ride. I didn't think it was going to be this up and down emotionally and physically. Went through challenges that were quite unexpected, but that's part of it. And I don't regret my decision. I still don't regret my decision for coming back. I think it was one of those things where I just had to get into it. It's really been a fun journey. It's gone from being kind of the underdog and being frustrated because I feel like I'm not in the game anymore, to now being more confident because, not because of the results I've had recently, but more about the confidence I've built because I've finally realized why I'm doing this and why I'm competing, and I don't really want to prove anything to anyone except myself. The one good thing about taking the year off, though, was the fact that it matured me emotionally, broadened my perspective on how to approach competitions mentally and emotionally. But that doesn't come without challenges, of course. My initial reaction is to say I don't deserve to go through this much challenge because I've gone through most of it, being a three-time world champion, I should have. But little did I know, there's still many, many challenges ahead.
You know, some days you work for it, some days it's, you know, a little more work than others, but nice, good job.
Hey, Patrick, from the ice to the indoor turf, next level training with your coach, Aaron. What's this sport give you?
Aaron specifically understands what skating needs when it comes to balance, endurance, and just power. Learning how to have good, better coordination, all those kind of exercises really do translate well to the ice. You know, at this point in my career, I want to have fun while I'm working.
How would you best describe how you relate to figure skating?
I'm a huge sport fanatic, and
I love skiing. I love my hobby in cars. I love soccer. I love my dog. I love all these other things that, but not, obviously not at an equal level as figure skating, because that is what's made me. It's definitely a roller coaster of emotions. It's a roller coaster of frustration with trying to please everybody. I've learned that you kind of have to give that up on trying to please everybody, because especially in a judge sport like figure skating, people are always going to have their opinions.
Brilliant performance by the Canadian Patrick Chen.
Feeling of landing on my feet on every element and breathing through it and being immersed in that world of whatever I'm trying to project in this program, that feeling is the greatest feeling and the best feeling above all. Skating has always been my anchor, where I can come in every single day and do something that makes me feel on top of the world.
Well, Yuzuru Hanyu has suffered only one loss this season, and it came at the hands of this man, Patrick Chen. That was at Skate Canada when Chen took gold and began the Grand Prix season. And there's Shoma Uno, the other Japanese skater. And this is his senior debut. What a year.
He's done a triple axel in warm-up that is twice his body length long. It was about 13 feet.
And there is the reigning world champion, the first time a Spaniard claimed the title. And he said he wants to be an ambassador for figure skating in Spain. Did every press conference and interview possible.
Well, you know, Javi's just such a charming guy. And I mean, four-time European champion, current world champion. He's not going to let that go without a big fight.
There's Dennis Ten, who's been dealing with a slew of injuries. It would just take too long to go through all of them. So I think it's even just impressive that he's here.
One of the easiest skaters to see skate when he's on. Mm. But when he's off, he's way off.
His career is like a soap opera by itself.
For example, this week in practice, not so much. The warm-up, right on. So who knows?
Well, he just claimed his sixth national title. And then, of course, yes, there is Patrick Chen. You have to wonder what he's thinking heading in.
I hope nothing. Seriously.
Just skate.
Actually, Patrick is one of those guys that skates well angry. And so let's hope he's angry on the short program, not waiting for the long program after a tough short.
And there's the 2014 Olympic gold medalist and reigning world silver medalist, Yuzuru Hanyu.
Who has done two quad triple combos in the warm-up that look like butter.
It's not fair, is it?
Makes it look easy.
He does.
And the Russian Maxim Kovtun.
Who can make it look really hard? He does really tough jumps. They're huge. He's very passionate, very focused, intense kid on the ice. And when he lands the jumps, man, you have respect, because he has a way of making them look like gravity's pulling on them really hard. But it's been a great warm-up. It's been one of those warm-ups where everybody in the building's going, this is going to be good.
Well, there's some heavy hitters in this fight.
Absolutely.
The sport has changed. The sport has evolved, and it's really tough to make it to the last flight at Worlds. And if you have, then you've really earned it all season, and you've got to bring it. Nobody wins Worlds anymore with an iffy skate.
First up here in this last flight is the young 18-year-old from Japan, Shoma Uno. Finished on the podium at every senior Grand Prix event this season, qualifying for the Grand Prix final, where he took the bronze.
And he is intense. Oh, his eyes are like a hawk looking for his next meal.
Now he's last year's world junior champion. Let's see what he can do at the senior level.
Proved himself worthy of being in the last flight at Worlds. Cannot argue. His musicality, his flow across the ice. He is small, but he skates big. And he jumps big, too. Quad toe. I'm sorry. That's the best one I've ever seen him do. Talk about timing.
He's got that ability to accelerate from nothing. He's going slowly and then whoosh, he's gone.
And he takes that speed with him up into the sky. He will do two spins back to back early in the program, pushing the last three jumps planned, two in combination and one alone, into the second half of his program, looking for a 10% bonus on those jumps. Reward for putting them late in the program. This will be a triple axel. Watch how far across the ice it goes.
The way his knees absorb that landing when it's gone so far across the ice is absolutely incredible.
Beautiful spread eagle entrance into that triple axel. Careful.
Oh.
Fly in the ointment there.
But again, his confidence, his presentation has improved so much just over the course of this season. Like you say, he's ready to play with the big boys, and
I'm
going to have to watch him.
Everyone clapping in the building. He is an American, by the way. He is not American, and they're clapping in time to his program.
Well, you can't help but get sucked in. Shoma Uno from Japan, the world junior, national junior champion last season, two-time national silver medalist as well. He is marking his territory on the senior level.
Just a little bit.
But we see a lot of those Japanese flags go up as well. But Javi Fernandez looking to defend his title is coming up next. Shoma Uno, the young 18-year-old from Japan, taking a bow there before exiting the ice. And he has gotten so used to winning on the senior circuit that he was really upset with his fourth place at Four Continents. So he just wants to be on that podium all the time. He's kind of set the trend for himself.
Perfect timing. Carol, you talk about how he transfers his knees into speed across the ice, but he also takes that speed, spread eagle here, and takes it up. This axel not really high, but long, really
wide,
long.
Yeah.
And he does tend to land with his left shoulder past center, I would call it.
Look how far he goes. Unbelievable.
And he has to work with that knee bend that he uses. He could be a great ice dancer, couldn't he?
He could.
And saves it. Now this is where it went bad. Tighten the shoulder up a little too high and could not pull the trigger for the triple. He gave up about 3 points at least, maybe 3.5 if he would have got a good GOE, maybe even four, who
maybe
knows?
Well, he's going to need to beat 89.87 to take the lead. No problem.
Ooh.
90.74 for him.
And he's happy. But
I don't know.
Well, he knows.
He's
what
thinking.
He left.
He's planning his next move.
There are some heavy hitters who are still to come. And that would include this man right here, the reigning world champ.
Someone remind me to breathe.
Oh. I think we're going to need the defibrillator before this event's over.
Just claimed his sixth national title this year. His fourth European title, only lost once this season, and that was at the hands of Yuzuru Hanyu. That was the Grand Prix final where he finished second.
Mm-hmm.
could just see that going on the takeoff, couldn't you? Just wasn't quite forward enough when he took off. But if ever a man was made to do a flamenco program, it's Happy.
One of the rare skaters that can take it to that place that's serious, right in the music, and he can also make it into a comedy if he wanted to. Very versatile skater, triple axel. He loves this jump. Oh! Past the sangria.
Scores of all time are owned by Yuzuru Hanyu, Patrick Chan, and this man, Javier Fernandez.
And let me guess, I was going to say.
So I think it's going to be a battle royal between the three of them.
But did Javi just leave the door open?
A little bit.
Javier Fernandez of Spain, the reigning world champion, the only man to win two Grand Prix this season, but saw that look on his face. But you know what? We'll have his marks when we return here on Road to the Olympic Games. Javier Fernandez of Spain just finished his short program. Whoop, there we go. Get the flower. Crowd still loving the reigning world champion, even though he did go down, Kurt.
Reaching back, quad toe. He takes a wonderful trajectory across the ice, allowing him to use his knee and the momentum to have those wonderful landings. But this time, the South Cow had a bit of a lean, leaning forward, and the toe pick couldn't hold him, lost the edge, dropped the right shoulder, which is your instinct, because when you're going down, you want to save yourself. All it does is make it worse. Trust me, I know. And the 3 to 4 points, plus whatever he would have got, GOE, that's a 4.5 mistake, probably.
Yes, probably.
And yes, that would mean the door's open. Yeah. But let's remember, nice quad toe triple. Triple axel was perfect. He gets positive grade of execution on everything else. I'm sure he's quite educated as well, speaks two languages. It's not
and
just
his hands. His component marks will be huge as
they
well.
Will be.
I mean, his choreography, the step sequences, the spins, the whole program was integrated, beautifully put together. A really beautiful piece of art.
Well, he's going to need 90.75 to take the lead here.
Yeah,
not 98.52.
And remember, he rotated the quad south completely before falling. It was a beautiful jump. The judges have their, they don't have to take off the full amount, which I don't think they probably did. And everything else was fantastic. What could have been? Oh, what could have been?
But that's key to remember, the fact that he did rotate. It depends on where you fall.
That's
sometimes.
Right.
The worst you can do is pop the jump.
Yes.
And then fall.
Here comes Denis Ten from Kazakhstan, last year's world bronze medalist. He's a six-time and reigning champ, national champ of Kazakhstan. And he's been on the podium in key competitions, right? Bronze at the 2014 Olympics. He was second as well at 2013 Worlds, and then the bronze.
But then there's the in-betweens, where he's dealing with injuries and inconsistencies. Which, Dennis, are we going to see today?
Just because he's been training badly...
Doesn't mean anything with Dennis.
Doesn't mean anything with Dennis. So...
off we go.
Don't go for popcorn.
Voyage of adventure.
Beautiful posture. I say it every time. Such an elegant skater. And an elegant jumper, too. Beautiful in the air. Quad toe, triple toe. There it is. No! Just late on the landing. Just didn't see the exit sign. Didn't pull the ripcord in time. Over-rotated, essentially. That was perfect.
Yeah. So now he's got to do the math, because he's got to find a spot to do that combination. Nice triple axel.
And it doesn't matter which jump really you do the combination off of. I think the judges should change it so that if you do the combination on a harder jump, you get more points. It just seems obvious to me. Sometimes when you pop a jump from a triple to a double, you relax just a little bit, almost like out of frustration, and then that happens. You lose your concentration, your edge changes, catch that edge.
And if you weren't planning it, maybe you weren't practicing it that much, and you weren't quite as prepared as you needed to be, so many things can impact on that.
Well, he really hasn't been practicing much. He missed 6 weeks to start the new year, withdrew from four continents, knee injury, groin, hip flexor, back, ankle, just to name a few of what he's been dealing with this season.
Beautiful program choreographed by Laurie Nicol. Absolutely, as always, superb.
Well, we got through it.
There is a skater to design a Laurie Nicol perfect program for. It is this one. He could do it. But this program was designed to be perfect.
Yes.
It's an unforgiving program.
Well, the music is so intense. If it's not going well, it's disaster.
Well, coming up after the break, it will be Patrick Chan taking to the ice at the world level for the first time since 2014. There's a look at the Japanese skater, Yuzuru Hanyu, doing some warm-ups before he will be taking to the ice. A little private time for himself there, whatever skaters need to do to get themselves ready. Looks like a little visualization. There's his coach, Brian Orser, just standing off to the side, knowing that his skater needs his moment.
I'm so curious. I wish there was a microphone over there.
That was fascinating.
Not that I speak Japanese.
Whatever it takes to get in the zone, and that is exactly what Canadian Patrick Chan is trying to do here. Get into the zone, conquer this short program. As you said at the beginning, Kurt, something that he's been struggling with all this season, trying to perfect it. We saw it at Nationals.
Yep.
So we know he can do it. He knows he can do it.
This is a sneak peek at what Patrick is doing. Well, I thought sometimes I liked to do a double axel. That was my thing before I skated, just to get my little tiny bit of air time, something I knew I was good at.
Gives you that comfort level, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You feel secure and organized.
What the skater's trying to do right now is be as normal as he can in an abnormal situation. And to allow your body to act naturally, to have the timing be the same as it is at home in practice. And pretend it's the same situation, which...
Just another day at the office.
Of course it isn't.
But of course we just finished watching the skate of Dennis Tan, and very disappointing for him. He will put himself in the 10th place position. Doesn't look like, at least right now, that he will be able to repeat last year's performance of bronze at the Worlds. Big mountain to climb for him to get back on the podium. And that's exactly what this man is going to try to do. Three-time world champion. He won it three straight years, 2011, 2012, 2013. And of course, took some time off right after the Olympics and then decided to take the entire year off. And now he's back.
One of the greatest skaters ever. And you cannot appreciate how good he is until you're actually on the ice with him. And then you're humbled. I always learn a lot about him in that opening sequence. Is his face relaxed? Is his knees working? And it looks good so far.
Right there with those little steps, you see the essence of Patrick Chan, those incredible skating skills.
Speed from nothing. Looking light and breezy, the shoulders are down. Triple axel. He's got work to do, no.
He has a love-hate relationship with that jump, and today, definitely not love. Weight transfer from one foot to the other, so seamless, so beautiful.
Chan back on world ice here in Boston, Massachusetts. A lot of Canadian flags, fans cheering him on. We will have his marks when we return here the 2016 Worlds. Very slight shake of the head there by the Canadian Patrick Chan. Try to take us inside his head, Kurt.
Well, we might hear it. Couldn't quite hear what they were saying, but I think that he was ready for a fantastic skate. He may have just felt that takeoff of the axle not be quite what he was looking for. A millisecond of doubt, and all of a sudden you're sliding across the ice, and that's it. That's the difference right there, because he looked on, didn't he?
Oh,
he
I thought on. That quad triple was the best one he's done all season.
You could see there was a lean. It did not. That the speed and momentum did not transfer back up into the sky in a way that he could rotate around himself, around his own core.
Yeah.
It was a bit of a struggle. He had to work to make the rotation happen. So when that happens, oh, and you can see the lean too.
Yeah.
From that
right
angle.
There.
Yeah, actually,
no,
it was mostly just the lean.
That.
I was getting all fancy, but really it was mostly just the lean.
Now, when you try to compare that to what Fernandez did.
Well, as far as punishment goes, it's exactly the same thing. They will lose approximately 3 to 4 marks. Javier probably lost the potential more because his quad sal can gain so much grade of execution, extra points put on by the judges. Patrick's triple axel isn't quite the kind of jump that the judges usually heap a lot of rewards to.
No. No, we're still seeing a smile, though. So he's going to have to get 98.53 to take the lead. But at least 89.87 to get on the podium, or in the top three,
he'll be
I should
right
say.
Between that.
And yeah, he will be. So that'll put him in second right
yeah.
now.
Live to fight another day.
That's right. Onward and upward.
Yep. You can't win it today, but you can take yourself out of it. And he did not take himself out of it.
And let's see if this man can bring the house down. We've seen him do it many, many times this season.
Well, he could probably build the house.
A very big house.
A very big house.
Not quite sure what he was saying to himself before taking to the ice there. We saw his little pre-skate ritual.
That was kind of intense.
Getting himself pumped up. It really was intense. But it's worked for him.
Nobody transfers speed across the ice into air time like he does.
No.
And nobody flows out of his jumps like he does.
Earlier in the week, he said he was out for revenge. Lost his world title to Fernandez, and he's made a statement that he wants it back. Zurhanyu right now basking in the afterglow will have his marks when we return. The crowd still on their feet here inside the garden. Zurhanyu putting on quite the performance. And you know, we've already seen him set records this year. Could he possibly set another one?
If this doesn't break the record, I'll be really shocked. There is such a thing as a perfect score for an element. And I think the triple axel and the quad toe combination deserve a perfect score. And the quad sow cow, I think you're having a look at it here. The quad, yes, from a spread eagle, difficult entrance, a tiny bit of a lean in the air, which he corrects in the air. It's not perfect, believe it or not. There you go, tiny correction with the hip. Look at that. And then show
and then
the judges
again
how much control you have with doing
wow.
spread eagle. So I don't know. If you never have seen ice before, let alone skating, you would look at this and think that is something special. He did not deserve to do the second triple.
No.
He was way too low.
Nobody else could have done that at all.
Yeah. It looked like he needed a stool to sit on. But no, I'm just going to triple.
And the triple axel going in from a back outside counter turn. How difficult is that? On top of the triple axel.
But it's the flow and the control out of his jumps. Look at how far that free leg reaches up into the sky, and then the body comes up to join it. It's so patient, so pure.
It's like he's on a mission to be the not just the best in the world, but the best there has ever been.
Too late. He already is. And you know what? Not everybody gets him. Like, some people think that, you know, it's, you know, they find them actually somewhat kind of boring. How is that boring? The intensity?
How is that boring? Look at that face.
And I think the look on Brian Orse's face when he was skating back towards Brian was the best. Just a slight shake and a smile going, I don't know how you do it, kid.
Well, that was a frightening face, but now he's got Winnie the Pooh with him.
All is good.
100.
He's done it again.
Now that actually doesn't match his season's best, 110.95, which is a record, but yeah, he'll take that.
Yeah, he's pretty good, really.
You know what? It was because that one combination was just a little low in the knee before he jumped.
Yeah.
Well, you better just fix that.
Picky, picky, picky.
Joining us now from Russia, please welcome our next competitor, Maxime Kovtun.
Now what?
Here comes a bit of a, talk about a pressure cooker there. Three-time and reigning national Russian champion, Maxime Kovtun. Looking to get the Russian men back in the conversation as well.
Well, the audience is in a good mood, and this music is a lot of fun, and this kid can fly. So all he has to do is, as I said, catch the wave. Don't get swept over by it. Join in the fun. Land your jumps, kid.
Well, all right, then.
That's how you join the party. A great opportunity for him to close the night out, skate after the Olympic champion. Keep the energy up. He's got another quad plant. Stay inside yourself. Reach back. No! A triple toe there by itself. It's a bigger mistake than you think, and I hope he doesn't think about it. He needs to concentrate. Triple axel, a little tight, but he got through it. And for all you Maxim fans out there, the bad news is he did a beautiful quad sal triple toe off the top, but then repeated the triple toe because he didn't rotate the four revolutions on the next jump. And we'll get no points for that effort whatsoever.
That jump math again, rearing its ugly head.
You cannot repeat a jump in the short program.
Kovtun from Russia, three-time and reigning national champion. Wanting to get the Russian men back in the figure skating conversation, they won seven consecutive world championships from 1998 to 2004, but have been on the podium only once since 2004, and Russia trying to identify who that young male skater will be to take them into the next Olympics.
Well, he had a tough job, too, following a performance like Uzuru's. That's not easy to skate after somebody's come out and lit the place up like that.
He looked like he was well on his way.
He did.
15,
I mean, the first
16
element
points
was great.
Off the first element. Yeah. Beautiful quad combination. And if you're going to screw up your second quad in the short, you've got to turn the jump. It's better to turn and fall.
And fall.
You'll get
yeah.
5 points for that. Even if you under-rotate it and fall, you'll get 3 points for that. If you do a second triple toe, you get 0 points for that and say goodbye. You're gone. But this was a beautiful moment. Wow, so over that right foot and able to correct on the toe. Well, what went wrong with the second one, Carol? Nope, this is quad sal again. Really spit.
And that was great. He was high, he was flying. Good control coming out. And actually, he went into the second quad looking good.
Really looking good.
Yeah.
He may have come around the corner a little hard on the three turn.
Here it is.
He really reaches down. I got to tell you, we would have to, you know, get a...
Dissect that in slow motion,
I think. Yeah,
I was
going to say, get a saw and look yeah. inside the head because I don't really know what went wrong there. Very tight. That one wasn't looking comfortable at all. So now, how did all the chips fall? He had a wonderful opportunity to be a player
yeah.
in this competition.
Some big, big scores already in the short that we've seen. I mean, he's going to have to put together a score of 94.85 to stay in the top three.
And the Russian boys have all struggled for years in the shadow of Yevgeny Plushenko, the famous Russian Olympic champion, who has sort of ruled the roost in
and rumor is he's going to come back and try
is he's coming back
get
again.
Back on the roost.
Yeah, so it's not been easy.
He's going to be bionic after all those surgeries.
Well, Kovtun defeated him at Nationals.
Yeah,
that'll put him down there. That'll put him in 13th.
Opportunity squandered there.
Real shame.
All right, well, let's head on down now to Scott Russell, standing by with one of the top three.
Javier Fernandez of Spain, they say the toughest thing to do is to defend a world championship. Have you done enough in the short program to give yourself a chance?
Yeah, definitely. I did have a mistake in the quad sal. I fall. But in the same time, it was a great program. I got a lot of points. And it is true that there is some skaters that they have to still skate and they have to get the scores. But I think with this short program, we're good to go for the free. And definitely, I'm going to have to try in the free program to make mistakes.
What's it like for you, Javi, to have three world champions in the field? Hanyu, yourself, Chen. That's good competition.
It is a really good competition, and definitely they won the title back. And I have to try to defend it with everything that I have. We'll see how the competition goes. I've been training really well, and I'm sure they did also, but I won this medal again.
Good luck.
Thank you very much, Scott.
Here is the man who looks like he's in a world of his own, and that's why he puts together otherworldly performances. Yuzuru Hanyu leading after a short. Boston, Massachusetts, looking beautiful at night. The site of the 2016 World Figure Skating Championships. Welcome back to Road to the Olympic Games, presented by Petro-Canada. A busy day ending with the men's short programs. Yuzuru Hanyu putting himself out of reach right now. 110.56 leading the way. The reigning world champion, Javier Fernandez, behind him. And the Canadian, Patrick Chan, on his comeback trail, putting himself in the top three. Here's Scott right now with the Canadian.
Patrick Chan, best short program of the season at just the right time.
Yeah.
Do you feel like you're back in the game?
Yeah, definitely. I feel like I've caught up, and I'm comfortable being in the last group, comfortable competing again, which was this year's goal. I think I've exceeded all my expectations already. So these worlds are really a bonus, no matter the result. And it wasn't... It was, I think, my season best this year, but this, unfortunately, I think it could have been better. I could have had a better turnout to the end of the season, especially the short program. So, but it is what it is, and this was a building year, not a I want to be the champion year. So, but there's still a lot to be seen in the long program.
So even in this championship now, where you sit,
mm-hmm.
optimistic about that free skate and ready to give it everything you've got, obviously.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah. I think what Four Continents has taught me is to not lose hope and to always give it 100%, no matter the results, no matter where you're standing in the group. Because for me, it's about the performance and how it feels to me personally. Honestly, I don't care about everyone else. I don't care about the audience, the judges, or the other skaters I'm competing against. It's all about me, and I have to be selfish. And I find that gives me my best performances, which in turn actually does affect the audience and everyone around me in a positive way.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Patrick doing what he needs to do to stay focused in this competition. But Kurt, we've said before that the short has caused him problems, but the free is where he's been making his comeback, so he's not out of this.
No, absolutely not. And what he's shown all of us, and most importantly himself, is that he can still compete. Yes, practices have been tough, the comeback has been hard, but his relationship with the axle is still tormenting him, but he's ready to do it and he should attack. And you know what? Today was a big, tough competition, and he's third in the world. It's pretty good.
Well, he's put himself within striking distance of second place, definitely. I mean, maybe first, might be out of reach with Hanyu skating like he's skating, but he's part of the conversation, and he's even given himself a little cushion from the other skaters behind him.
Well, we always said that if Yuzuru Hanyu was going to lose this, it's because he would do something wrong, and he would gift it. But he's not wrapping a bow on anything for anyone.
No.
This was his moment.
And I guess what's hard to really understand, even for somebody who has skated his whole life, is how do you do a program with such technical difficulty at such a high level, with the entrances to the jumps, with the exits to the jumps, the flow, musicality, intensity, connection with the audience, and I don't have time to keep going.
He's just the magical unicorn of skating. That's how he does it.
Well, we cannot wait to see the free and what he can put together there and possibly regain that world title. Let's go back now ringside with Scott.
Hey, Andy, great competition in the men's. Also, the ice dancers got going today here at the Garden with the short dance. A lot of focus on the Canadian champions, Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poget. They were a close second at the World Championships in 2014, a close third in 2015. They've had a great season and won the Grand Prix final in Barcelona. Let's see how they do in the short dance here in Boston, courtesy of the call of Andy, Carol, and Kurt.
Of Canada. Please
Please welcome to the ice, Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poggi.
And here come the Canadians, Weaver and Poggi. Just saw a feature on them. Caitlin in tears, that just shows how much sweat and tears go into preparing for competition, but not just any competition, the world's, and how badly they want that title. They have a silver, they have a bronze, they want the other color. I think their costume in this short dance is absolutely gorgeous. If you're going to do a Strauss waltz, do it dressed like that.
It helps when you wake up in the morning looking like that.
There's
and
that.
Then dress it. And they do want it so bad. The trick now will be to trust their training, not think about the goal at the end of the rainbow, and just enjoy the dance.
Beautiful curve lift, Andrew on one leg there. Lovely smooth exit. Off they go into their waltz. This short dance has really been a hit with judges and audiences again this year. It's always nice when you can go into a competition knowing it's been successful already.
Strides. I almost feel like this ice surface is too small for them.
Well, they're such an elegant team and they cover the ice so effortlessly. Twizzle's done. That can be a little bit of a tricky element for them, as it was for Chalk and Bait, so they'll be very happy to have gotten through that nicely.
Nothing gained, nothing lost, and that's
all right.
And to think they were actually going to dance to Elvis
that's
in their
right.
short dance before the season started, and they changed that up pretty quickly.
Stoical or impressive?
You have to be a little bit psychic when you're picking programs for the short dance because you just don't know what's going to resonate.
People getting to their feet here for the Canadian couple of Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poggi.
Canadian champions Caitlin Weaver, Andrew Poggi. It appeared to be little bits of everything, but are you close enough?
I actually have no idea. I haven't been able to look at the computer screen to see what our levels were. It's not the position we want to be in, absolutely not, but we're fighters, and we're fighters to our core, and this isn't over till it's over.
It's an incredibly deep and strong field. Andrew, do you feel you're contending here with that short dance?
I mean, absolutely. We're proud of the way that we performed out there today. Obviously, we want to finish off at different places, but we were happy with how we finished our program and our performance.
Obviously, optimistic about the free dance.
Absolutely. That's my middle name. And like I said, we've worked so hard. We're not giving up just yet.
All the best of luck to you both.
Thank you.
Surprising results. World champions Gabriela Papadakis, Guillaume Cizeron lead. Then it's the Americans, the Chibutanis, Chalk and Bates. Weaver Poggi in fourth, 4.5 points back. Canadians Piper Gillis, Paul Poirier had a great skate, a personal best, and stand fifth. Now back to Andy, Carol, and Kurt.
Well, Scott, let's talk about
Piper and Paul, and who best to talk about them with than their actual coach, Carol Lane, who was jumping out of her seat when they set that personal best. How happy are you to see them in the top five?
Oh, I'm just overjoyed, Andy. I mean, it was a fabulous skate for them today. We'd made a few changes after Four Continents, changed the music around a little bit, adjusted some of the elements in the program, really worked on our key points in the Ravensburger Waltz, and they just skated today with such freedom and enjoyment in the program, and it came across to everybody, the audience, the judges. You could just enjoy everything they did. I mean, how wrong can you go with the Beatles, really, when you get right down to it?
Well, for me, it was, you know, sometimes somebody's in 10th place, but they're the skate of the night. Mm-hmm. And I just felt that this was the performance of the night, the integrity between the two people, and the enjoyment that they had within their own program and the way they shared it with everybody. It was awesome.
Well, you couldn't help but get wrapped up into it. It was a crowd pleaser. It was great seeing the expressions on their face when they saw that they set a personal best.
Yeah, and that now was
sitting,
mine too.
It was great sitting in fifth, but I think we are shocked when we're talking about 2 years ago, the world champions, that would be the Italian couple. Not only are they sitting in sixth, but they're about 6 points away from the top spot as well.
Yeah. Well, you know, it all boiled down to those pesky little technical difficulties right there in the twizzles. They weren't securely done. There was an extra rotation. Took away from their grade of execution. And when it's so tight at the top, and in ice dancing there's only five elements, you know, if you make a little mistake on a couple of them, especially in that Ravensburger Waltz, you pay dearly. And that's what happened to them, unfortunately, today.
So they're sitting in six, but sitting in top spot, the reigning world champions, and that would be Gabriela Papadakis and Guillaume Cizeron. And this is really only their third competition. We talked about her having to deal with the concussion in August, and they look like they're poised to take the win again.
They've been able to put up big scores in competition. Well, I guess just one competition at the European Championships.
That's right.
So they look like they're ready to do the same thing, maybe repeat as world champions. And sure enough, they're in first place. They weave a spell. If you get caught up in that spell, you can't see anything else. And I didn't quite get caught up in it as much as everyone else.
When we return on Road to the Olympic Games, speaking of world champions, there is Tessa Virtue, Scott Moore, who will be joining our Scott Russell next.
Road to the Olympic Games, presented by Petro-Canada. Nice scenic of Boston, Massachusetts, springtime. And the World Figure Skating Championships on CBC for 2016. Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer, two-time world champions, the Olympic champions in 2010. Well, we have to talk about the ice dance first. And some surprising results in the short dance, particularly with regard to where Caitlin Weaver and Andrew Poggi stand, right?
Yeah, that's right. The entire last flight really had us on the edge of our seats. There were some really emotional performances, but it all came down to that technical mark. And I think, you know, that's where you see some shifting in placement.
Scott, you have been behind, as they are now, at points in your career. And yet it is doable to get back on top. What's the mentality that you have to bring to that situation?
Well, you really have to restart. And, you know, there are more points to be to take home in the free section. So you have to make sure you come ready to go when it's not over yet. So I know they're not where they want to be, but there's still hope for Caitlin and Andrew to win the world title.
I have to ask you one quick question about Patrick Chan, comeback season. He looked pretty good in that short program.
He had a little swagger.
He looked great. I thought he was well composed and had confidence when he took the ice. We really enjoyed that program.
Hanyu's good, but Chan's right in the game. Are you correct with that?
Yeah, I mean, he is a bit back, but he can do it. It's Chitty. He can do anything.
All right. Thanks very much, Tessa Virtue and Scott Moyer. The all-important men's free program goes on Friday night. Three world champions in the field. All of them continue the chase. It will be quite a contest in Boston. And tomorrow at 2 p.m., the ladies' short program, three-time world champion Mao Asada is in the field. Young Russians, Americans on home ice, Elaine Chartrand and Gabby Daleman for Canada. For all of us, thanks for watching, and we'll see you tomorrow at the Garden.